first guest presided over the Senate hearing on various measures seeking to impose a 12% value-added tax on digital transactions last week. He says the Senate Ways and Means Committee is one with the national government in its quest of increasing revenue to support priority programs and provide a fair playing field between physical and online transactions. Senator Sherwin Gatchalian, thank you so much for joining us this morning, sir. Hi.
Good morning, Mimi. Good morning to our televiewers.
All right. So what's the latest on the proposal to impose a 12% VAT on digital transactions? Are you going to be starting to tax them this year?
Well, Mimi, this is not a new imposition. The 12% VAT is being imposed on physical goods right now in our country. So if you buy anything in shopping malls or even domestic online marketplaces, you have to pay 12% VAT. So it's not a new imposition. So what we're doing right now is to plug the gaps with digital services providers. So for example, websites like Netflix or Amazon data centers, which are hosted outside of the Philippines, are not being imposed 12% VAT because our law does not require so. And so this proposal is to plug the gaps so that digital service providers outside of the Philippines will be mandated to also pay VAT on their services that they provide here in the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. And you're looking to raise some 97 billion pesos from this, right?
It's about 17 billion per year on average, 97 for the next 5 years. Mm-hmm. So it will gradually increase because a lot of these digital service providers will be mandated to register. The first step is to register. Mm-hmm. So all of these websites will have to register in the Philippines. And after registering, VAT will be imputed in their retail cost to consumers here in the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. Do we have the tools to track them, to size them up, and to collect from them?
That's a very good question, Mimi. In fact, we discussed that during the hearing. Theoretically, yes, we have. The recourse for these websites, for example, if these websites will not register or these websites will fail to collect VAT, the recourse for the BAR is to close down the website. Based on the information from the DICT, they have the tools to do so, but they have to review whether those tools are readily implementable and it can be implemented on a global scale. If you remember, the DICT has the capability of shutting down domestic websites. So in theory, they have that capability, but we're now talking about global websites. We're not talking about the huge big tech companies of the world. So they still have to get back to us in terms of that capability. Mimi, it's also worth noting that in the 11 ASEAN countries, seven have already imposed VAT on digital service transactions. So in other words, we're the minority. We're one of the five who do not impose VAT on digital service transactions. So in other words, the whole world is moving into this direction. A lot of the, actually all of the OECD countries have this type of imposition. So we're actually in the minority and we're actually the last few countries who are not imposing VAT on digital service transactions.
Mm-hmm. Actually, Senator, you mentioned the OECD. They're calling it the Pillar One, right? The digital services tax. I understand it's not yet final because there are countries like the U.S. who are opposed to this because they take it as a hit to Silicon Valley companies that are based in the U.S.
The OECD has actually provided guidelines and toolkits for countries to impose. So what they want is to impose this uniformly across different jurisdictions as much as possible. Of course, it's not going to be 100% uniform because we have different rates, different imposition, but as far as practicable, they recommend to implement it as uniform as possible so that companies, multinational companies, will not have problems implementing this or will not have arbitrage or will not arbitrage in terms of tax rates. Mm-hmm. So admittedly, some countries are still looking into imposing this, but majority, especially here in ASEAN, majority of the countries have already imposed VAT on digital transactions. Majority of OECD countries have already imposed VAT on digital service transactions.
Senator, I'm very curious. We're talking about all websites that cater to Filipinos, that we want to tax these websites. Do you really think the DICT can do this? I mean, there are just so many of them all over the world.
Well, the first, like I said, the first step will be registering. It's a self-imposition, the first step, no? Because the country now mandates this type of websites to register with the BIR and impose VAT, and at the same time remit that VAT to the BIR. But Mimi, we have a 3 million threshold. So those websites that are just doing one-off transactions are not required to register. Small and micro businesses whose transaction is below 3 million are not required to register. So we're just looking at the big regular websites who do this as a living. You know, for example, like I mentioned, you know, Netflix, Amazon data services, YouTube is a big online advertisers. And this YouTube is also competing with our local advertising agency, but our local advertising agency pays VAT, 12% VAT, but YouTube does not, no, because of the gap in the law. So we're just evening out the playing field so that these companies operate in the same plane.
And for these companies who are doing their operations maybe in the U.S. but are selling goods or services here in the Philippines, won't this be double taxation for them?
No, because, for example, if you order from Amazon, no, Amazon has so many services.
Yeah.
They have data services, they have digital services, they have products, online products. Those online products, if it goes beyond 10,000 pesos, you pay VAT once the products come to here in the Philippines and they are at the customs jurisdiction. So in other words, for online products, we already pay 12% VAT.
It's the services.
So it's digital services that are not being imposed 12% VAT. In other words, everything in the Philippines, whether services, products, are being imposed 12% VAT. It's only this gap in the law that we are plugging.
Senator, are you not worried that this could cause friction with our trading allies? I mean, I remember 2 years ago, then-President Donald Trump, when France imposed the same digital services taxes on Silicon Valley companies, what Trump did was impose taxes on additional tariff on French wine, French cheese, for example.
No, Mimi, it's just evening out the playing field. Our local companies, for example, iWant TV of ABS-CBN, if they sell their Filipino movies, let's say to Singapore, Malaysia, it's being imposed VAT or GST in their jurisdictions. So Filipino companies here who sell services, digital services, to another jurisdiction is being imposed GST or VAT already. So everyone's doing the same. No? So we're just moving our country to the same level because VAT is a global best practice that is being imposed both for physical services, physical goods, and digital transactions.
So we're working more on uniform tax regimes in ASEAN. Are there also efforts, Senator, to be uniform with the bigger economy, the bigger global economy, like the Western countries?
I think making our tax rates uniform is still a long way to go. Looking at the VAT/GST tax rate, it varies from 5% all the way to 17%. So it's different per jurisdiction. Of course, it's a political decision on the part of the country. So we're still a far way from coming up with a single or a uniform tax rate. What we're trying to put as uniform is the process and the principle of imposing VAT on digital services transactions.
So what's the timeline, Senator? So you've done the hearing. What's next? How soon before this gets passed?
The lower house have already approved this bill, so it has been transmitted to us, I think, early part of this year. So the next step will be we're entering a technical working group to iron out a lot of the details. Of course, what we want is clarity in the law that we will produce. And we're trying to shoot a completion of this bill by before end of the year.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. All right. And final question, sir. Done and dusted the Maharlika Investment Fund. Now just waiting for the president's signature, but so many questions remain. Any thoughts? How can we make this work?
Well, the questions will always be there, no? Because there are different opinions. If you talk to different investment bankers, if you talk to different economists, they will have different opinions in the different principles of Maharlika Investment Fund. That will never go away. What's important right now is we have the law, and the law has imposed so many safeguards, Mimi. From the early version of this law to the final version of this law, if you look at the safeguards, from for example, in the Senate, we removed the exemption from the procurement law. We remove the exemption from the GCG law. We explicitly prohibited investment in government-run pension funds. The government governance structure has also been improved under the Senate version. So there's so many restrictions and safeguards in this Maharlika, the new, the Senate version at least, no? Maharlika Investment Fund. So what we need to do is to make sure that the president and the administration appoints qualified and qualified and honest management of this fund. It will boil down now to the personalities who will be managing and running this fund.
All of them are going to be Malacañang appointees?
All of them, well, not all, no. There will be independent directors, there will be independent members. So they are appointees because by law they have to be appointed by someone, but the qualifications and their backgrounds will be very important, and that's specified under the law.
Mm-hmm. And I know, sir, that you've always said that the purpose of the Maharlika Fund is very clear. There are still some observers who say that this fund sounds like an everything everywhere all at once.
Well, again, no, different people will have different opinions. When we were discussing this bill, we narrowed down and cleared down the objective of the bill. Of course, when you talk to some people, they'll say it's still broad. But I think what is important here is the discussion during the debates and the intention of the bill. The intention is very clear, no, to use the fund as a catalyst to invest in infrastructure, as a catalyst to invest in nation development. And that is the intention of the bill. It's reflected in the declaration of policy, it's reflected in the debates. And we're quite confident that the direction that is designed for this fund is quite clear.
All right, on that note, Senator Sherwin Gachalian, thank you so much for joining us this morning, sir.
Thank you very much.